On the agenda for tonight's live analysis, we're going back to 1972. We're going to be taking a look at Badfinger, and they're going to be performing Baby Blue. Hello, Phil here from Wings of Pegasus, and welcome to another live analysis video. Thank you guys for joining me tonight. If you do enjoy this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe. Hello in that live chat room. We have Leanne in there, Vince and Velvet, Lisa Orlando, Billy, Deborah, Lynn, Jeff, and thank you everyone for joining me. So we're going to be going through this in exactly the same way as we do a normal analysis video. It's just that this one is live. So we're going to be getting Badfinger up on screen, and this is going to be their performance in 1972 on the Kenny Rogers show, which we're just about to see. And just to give you a heads up, I'm probably going to jump into the video. That's what I do on these live analysis videos, and we'll get into the analysis and then resume the video and probably get the guitar out at the end of the video to break things down a little bit as well. So let's get Badfinger and Kenny up on screen. We'll jump into this and see how they get on.
Ladies and gentlemen, Badfinger.
I'm just going to jump in here. Like I said, if you want to watch it the whole way through, you can click on the link in the description below and watch it the whole way through without me interrupting it. So there are a few things just to bring up to begin with, because from a technical point of view, this being on a TV show, often what used to happen is that bands would either mime completely and not even sing, or they would have a backing track that they'd run off in the studio that didn't have a lead vocal on it. And that's what we've got here with this particular setup. It means that the vocals, even though they sound like they're from the record and they are spot on the whole way through, they are live, and it's sometimes difficult to believe because the harmonies there are so spot on. But the killer is always to have a look at the drums and what's going on with Mike in the background here. Mike Gibbons, by the way, on drums, because when you're playing live, and when these guys are playing live on TV, when they had to play over a backing track, it meant that the drummer couldn't really hit the hi-hat or the crashes, the cymbals, because that will cut through on a record. The top end of the hi-hat and those cymbals are just taken off, else it'll be really offensive to your ears, whereas live you can't take off that top end because you're right in front of the drum kit. So you'll see the way that Mike, when he's doing his runs, he'll just ever so slightly tickle each crash. He's not really going for it because that would be too loud and it would start to mask over the backing track. Having said all of that, these guys most definitely could play live exactly as you hear it on the record, because everything that they are playing, hand positions, picking, strumming, is all spot on, to the point where I think you have to really play yourself in a band or probably have some kind of history in production as well to tell that this isn't being played live. They might actually have a feed from the guitars that's in the mix there, because they might as well have that in. You can see the amps in the background being mic'd up, and the fact that we have got some leads coming out of the guitars, so it might be that backing track setup, but with the guitar still in there. Interestingly, when you listen to the record, you'll find that if you're playing along with it or attempting to play along with it in standard tuning, the tuning is ever so slightly out. It's slightly sharp on the original, or at least what you'll hear on YouTube as being the original, and it's slightly faster. So I think what's happened there is the tape has been sped up a little bit, so the pitch has increased and the tempo's therefore increased, and that's why it's slightly out of tune. If you're playing along with this at home, you'll be absolutely fine because the guys are in standard tuning here. So just to throw that out there, that we have got totally live vocals and it just sounds like the record. It is so spot on. Another thing that I just want to draw your attention to is the way that with the backing vocals that we've got here from Tom Evans, his range, he's hitting notes way up there. We're talking about a C sharp 5, and I always mention about the C5 being the holy grail, and just the fact that Tom is going above that in order to harmonize with Pete on lead vocal, Pete Ham. And the thing about Pete's voice, as well as just having that range that he's got that ever so slight sound of Paul McCartney in his voice when he does push up to those A4s and B4s, and when he is really starting to get into the upper range and pushing his chest voice, there's that hint of Paul McCartney in there. And I have got another video on Bad Finger, so make sure you check that out as well, because they're one of those stories, a tragic story. And I'm not going to cover it all in this video, but I have already done it in another video where I have a look at the whole band, get into the history as well. But here, it's one of those things that's always going to be drawn alongside the Beatles, with Badfinger being signed to Apple Records. And unfortunately, the whole Apple Records thing really did fall through in the end. But having the same recording studio and having the same recording techniques, I think it's inevitable that they're going to sound like the Beatles, because all of the same production techniques are going to be used. So it's something that you'll find, especially on the record, not live here because it is literally just two voices, but they would multi-track the vocals in the studio. So you start getting that chorus sound to the backing vocals, and you certainly hear that with the Beatles as well. So we've got some really interesting things going on here from the technical aspects and the vocals being so spot on. We do have the guitar solo that's about to come in, but when we're mentioning about a guitar solo, the intro, verse, and the chorus, this is something that is prevalent in Beatles songs as well, where you're not really sure what part of the song you're in, because we had the intro here and then we get into the verse, but then it sounds like the verse just blends into what would be the chorus, because we hear the baby blue vocal line and that little hook that's in there, it sounds like it's at the end of maybe a verse or a chorus, and then we get into a bridge or a mid-late, as it's also called. So they hit you with two verses to begin with, or what you think are verses, but it's just one of those things that has been pieced together in such a way that you're not really sure what to call each part of the song. And we have that solo to break it up in there as well. And we'll break this all down on the guitar a little bit later on. But we are going to be jumping back into the song. Just before we do, a big thank you for the donations in the super chat window thing that's going on in this live analysis, because we are live at the moment. Thank you, Deborah, for your donation, and Kathy as well. And I will address all of these a little bit later on as well. Orlando, I'll have to adjust the screen because I can't quite see all of them at the moment. But thank you guys so much for the donations. We are going to be jumping back into the track and we'll watch the video all the way to the end. And then we'll bust out the guitar a little bit, maybe talk about this song and how, I'll mention it now, that there's a series called Breaking Bad. I'm sure you guys have seen that, or the majority of you have. And in 2013, they did feature this song. And it meant that in the UK, it did actually chart. And it was the first time that it did chart. It got to number 73, I believe, when that was released in 2013, or at least everybody heard it on Breaking Bad and then started to download it and buy it. And it was much more successful, especially considering in the UK that it hadn't been released at all. And that gives you an idea of the problems that they were having with the record label, with Apple, and just having so many money troubles and not being able to release songs, because it was due to be released, this song, in the UK. And we're talking way back. I mean, this is 1972 here. It was supposed to be released back when they're performing this video, but it wasn't, because they just messed it up, really. It was, they'd had everything designed and the pictures done for the single and everything, but it just didn't come to fruition, unfortunately. And it then did chart in the UK for the first time in 2013. So it gives you an idea of how much of a problem the record label were having at that time. But anyway, let's jump back into the video and then we'll get into maybe breaking down some chords and talking a little bit more after. But let's jump back into it. Have it. That vocal performance is so spot on, and you'll see the way as well that everything that's being played here, even though it's not really being played, they might have that amp being in the mix in some kind of level. It does sound a little bit guitar heavy, but that's on the original record as well. But when we do look at Joey playing the lead guitar, you can see sometimes that when he did a bend and there's no vibrato on the bend, but he was playing vibrato with his technique at the time. So, but you know that these guys can do it live. It's just because of TV that they weren't able to do it. It was a lot easier to get live vocal set up rather than miking up the whole band and the drum kit and all of that. It is a bit of a faff, especially when you just want a quick performance on TV. But we are going to be getting into the guitar work as well. Again, thank you everyone for joining me tonight, and Kathy for that $1.99 donation, and Orlando as well for that $2 donation. It is much appreciated. And we are going to be jumping into getting the guitar out. So I'm going to have to get rid of the screen to make sure that you can see what's going on here. And hopefully you guys are going to be able to hear this guitar and it's going to be okay. I'll explain things a little bit more slowly because as you can see, I've got the gem out. And this is Mario's guitar, by the way, and you'll know Mario from the live streams, but I'll explain things slowly because you might not be able to get a reference point as to where the dots are and where the 5th fret and the 7th fret are on this guitar. But when we're breaking down this song, we're going to busk our way through it, but straight away we're going to be, and hopefully you guys will be able to hear this, we're going to be starting in B. You won't have that kind of vibe to it. Interestingly, in the live performance, you'll see that we've got this sus4 sound. And that's the sus4 coming in and out. And that'll be in the intro as you play through. You could see the way that I went down to the B on that 2nd fret to supply that sus4, because that is what's going on in this video sometimes from Joey when he moves down. Pete's very much just playing the basic rhythm here, but what you'll find is that on the record and on a bit of this track as well, you get two guitars that are added together because that's how it was played on the record. And you might find that you're playing one version of the rhythm and you don't know how to get the other part of the rhythm in there. You have to play very specific voicings of chords in order to get the right notes that you can hear that are prominent in the mix of the record and this live performance. So when we've got this B, we're jumping up to, and all of that, you know, we've got our E here, our F, and then the F sharp is where you want to go up to after playing your B. And I'm telling you all of the notes because of the fretboard might not be very clear, but for reference, I'm on the 7th fret here. So this is my standard B bar chord that we've got. But this, and what you'll find here is this is where you might run into your first problem, because in order to do the little rundown that is prominent in the mix, you're going to have to get down into your C position here, the C position of E, so that, because that will now give you your notes that you can pick out. Because if you pick out the other chord, you're going to get the root note, the 5th, and the octave, and those aren't the notes of the run. You want to get your little finger on your root note there, and then you get your 3rd in there. That's the real difference. So you get that, and then take that little finger just down in order to get the run. So there are little parts that are throughout this song. For example, we've got this little major scale running through on the B. Also later on, we have exactly the same there with that F sharp. So it's just a little run that's going to lead you into the next section, and it's really nice to have that in there. And it is something that I've mentioned in other videos, the way that you can just take a scale, because we're in our major key here, major chord, major chord. It means that once you've got your do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do major scale, you can just take notes from that. And that's exactly what we've got here, but just reversing it and descending once you get to the 5th, like that. So it just makes it interesting to have a little run between the chords. And the other thing that I really like about this song is the fact that it does take you by surprise, the way that we kind of jump down. We've got that little C sharp in there as well, and the C sharp minor 7th. We've got some really cool changes going on here, and we go over to our A as well, into the E again, into the So we've got some really nice stuff going on from a rhythm perspective, and it's just piecing together the two chords and the two voicings of chords with, because you're not going to be able to get that little run in there if you're playing the chord up here. And this is something that you'll see when we're playing that little F sharp in there. You'll find that the root note here is being played again in this C shape, this C position, and this is what Pete's doing on the guitar. So he's going, and he's taking that shape down two frets, A, E, B, and then starting again with the F sharp back into the verse. And yeah, before we get into the chorus, it's not really a chorus, but just getting into the baby blue, we'll have that little run as well. So there's lots of interesting stuff going on here from a guitar perspective. And this is the other thing, that when we get into the solo, it's something that has got a lot of technique in there. And it is also coming off the back of the E, but now down to a D, like that. And when I say that there's a lot of technique, I mean, we are pretty much going to be in our major scale here. So all of our notes are going to be played in and around that fifth fret with the A, and that's exactly what we've got here from Joey. And we've got this really melodic stuff, same kind of thing. And I think we do have a little bit of bending in there as well. So when we have that, that kind of thing. So having a bend and really exaggerating that vibrato with the, but always in control, and just bending the note, or bending the string to the note that you want, and then applying a slow controlled vibrato takes so much technique. And you'll see that all the way here with the whole solo. It's totally under control. I know that technically it's mimed over the backing track, but you can tell by the way that Joey's fretting this that he's all over it, and he's playing exactly what he did in the studio. And when we get up to the, and then we've got him, something like that. I'm kind of busking the solo a little bit there, but there's all that control, and it's all about melody as well. This is something that you'll find with Badfinger as a band in general, and other bands pretty much in the 60s and the 70s. They always focused on melody first, and it didn't matter about playing a million notes a second. It was all about getting that melody and getting it to sit within the song, which is exactly what we've got here, to the point where we've got our chord shapes pretty much going to be, yeah, all of our notes that are part of our major scale are where we are. So you can start to throw together little lead lines in exactly the same way, using that same principle of taking a major scale and just taking notes from it, and just having a little play around with that. And of course, when we, by the way, I didn't mention that the chords underneath the solo are going to be the D, the A, the E, and the B. So that's why when we get this sliding up, we're resolving to that B chord, and that's why you have that little slide up, and why it's so melodic the whole way through. So it's really well put together, this whole song. I mean, it is a song that I am a big fan of, because it's got the little guitar solo in there. It's simple, but it's melodic. And the way that the whole song's been put together, the way that the mid-late and the bridge comes in, just mid-late and the bridge is the same term for a, If you don't know, I'm sure that you know by now if you watch this channel for any length of time what it is, but it's a little segment within a song that has a different set of chords that's going to just give you a different sight on the journey of the song, and it's going to be totally different to the rest of the song. So this is why when you think you've heard a verse and a chorus and then it goes into something that's totally different, you would call it a middle eight and a bridge, but then you're not really sure, which is just alluding back to the point that I made earlier about the Beatles having that writing style and certainly Badfinger having here. And just to throw in as well that this was one of Pete's songs that he wrote, Pete Ham, the lead vocalist that you can see here. And yeah, it's one of those things that unfortunately with the story of Badfinger, like I said, check out the video that I've done already. It is a very sad story, but they're such a talented band, and it is a really sad end to what they were doing. And just to mention Stan Polley, who was, I'm sure you guys already know this, but Stan Polley, who was the manager, and manager, if you type it in on, well, just type it into Google, but you'll find the Stan Polley is on Wikipedia as well, and his description is, and it's something like an entertainment manager and fraudster, and that really does sum him up well. And it's amazing how he basically did these guys out of every cent, or well, every pound, because coming from England, but over in the USA, every cent that they made. And yeah, it ultimately ended up in, unfortunately, Pete committing suicide. And yeah, it's not a very nice story at all. And Tom did as well. He committed suicide. So these guys were really taken advantage of back in the day. And yeah, check out that other video, because it is a cautionary tale. I think everybody who's involved in the music industry needs to just check out Badfinger, not only from a musical perspective, because there's so much going on here, but also from a professional perspective and looking at the music industry, because these guys are probably one of the examples of being totally done over in the music industry and absolutely losing everything. But great musicians, great music, and I know that I want to keep these analysis videos in less than half an hour, and it is quite difficult to do that, but just to mention as well that Todd Rundgren was a producer on this track, and I have another video on Todd if you want to check that out. But just to look into this Super Chat window as well, because we have had another donation from Bonnie, so thank you so much for that $20 donation. And Common Sensible as well, who has donated $5 as well. Thank you for that, and welcome everybody watching this live analysis. I do these every Wednesday night, so you can check out a live analysis alongside the other analysis videos that I do. But hopefully this has given you a flavor of it. And thank you guys so much for joining me on this one tonight. We did have a bit of a crash course on the chords there, but these analysis videos aren't going to be instructional videos. I'm not going to be breaking it down and going through every single chord and all of the picking, but suffice to say that there's a lot of good playing going on here and on that original record. The most important thing is getting the voicings of the chords so that you can get the prominent lines in the mix that do come out when you do pick through them. But I want to say a big thank you to everybody for tuning in tonight. I'll be doing this again next Wednesday night at the same time, at the same place here on YouTube. And I'll see you guys at the next analysis video. I'm always in the comments section, as you can see me thumbs upping and hearting all the comments that I've read. And hopefully I'll see you guys at a live stream, which is a little bit different because we go through a pick roulette and do things like that and play some original music and a cover and all that kind of stuff that's requested over on Patreon. So you guys know how it works, the normal viewers of those live streams. But thank you guys for tuning in to this live analysis. I hope that you have enjoyed it, and I will hopefully see you at another one, and hopefully I will see you guys at the next live analysis, and I'll see you guys then. And I'm gonna have to put my pick in my mouth in order to do the rock, because I need to click the mouse. But thank you guys so much for joining me, and I'll catch you guys at the next one. Rock!